Hi everybody, my name is Metea Sinclair Wise and I am a senior music therapy major here at SRU. And during the summer, a fellow colleague of mine, Daniel Jeffrey, who is a senior music education major here at SRU, approached me about a project idea that he had had. This project was to highlight music that was written as a response to a movement or an event. The goal was to shed light on these pieces and show how music can be used as a healer. In writing a proposal for the dean in order to get a green light for this project, I described the idea as follows. We want this project to span out and show beautiful diversity. When we hear about these terrible events, we feel awful. Our hearts ache for the people who were affected and those communities that mourn. We seem to fall away from the beauty and the strength that these communities exude, though. And this project is focusing on that. We want to be able to highlight the strength that is shown through movements and the beauty that has come out of tribulation. In this project, we would like to focus on music that has come as a response. The pieces we want to highlight were made as a reflection on the persecution that these communities have gone through, and how they took what could have been a complete setback and turned it into something beautiful and powerful. These songs show how people took back their own strength. We would like to make a series of short videos, each discussing a certain musician and a song that they wrote or performed in response to a massive life-changing event of some sorts. An example of this would be Black Parade, written and released by Beyoncé this summer on June 19, 2020, also known as Juneteenth. This song was written as a response to the media resurgence of the Black Lives Matter movement, as well as in celebration of Juneteenth. Our goal is to have students volunteer to make a short video so that we can end up with a compilation of quite a few videos. Each student will present some background information on the event that sparked the piece of music that they chose, the artist who wrote the music, and the music itself. The student will then proceed to perform said piece of music. Our hope is that we get a good team of musicians to participate and create a video full of diversity that showcases the strength of community. I have spent the past 2.5 months bringing this idea to life. I have spent hours researching, video editing, and preparing music myself. In the following, you will hear scripts that each student has read before performing their piece. These quote-unquote scripts are a very shortened summary of compiled research that details why the piece was written, as well as short background information on the artists that wrote each song. These scripts, as well as the pieces, are done in chronological order. They will be shown as follows. Four African Dances, Opus 58, number 1 in G minor, Allegro, written by Samuel Coleridge-Taylor in 1904 and performed by junior music therapy and dance major Ella Hickey. The March of the Woman by Dame Ethel Smyth in 1910 and performed by senior music therapy major Delaney Rhodes. Hot Sonata by Erwin Schulhoff, written in 1930, performed by senior music education major Daniel Jeffrey. Somewhere Over the Rainbow by Harold Arlen, with lyrics written by Yip Harburg in 1939, performed by sophomore music education major Leah Buchek. Ain't Gonna Let Nobody Turn Me Round, a traditional African-American spiritual that was first recorded by the Fairfield Four in 1947 and performed by post-bachelor music therapy student Madge Dietrich. Singing for Our Lives by Holly Near in 1990, performed again by post-bachelor music therapy student Madge Dietrich. Looking for America, a song written by Lana Del Rey in 2019. It'll be performed by sophomore music education major Hannah Digidio. BLM by music therapy intern Hannah Floyd and SRU music education alum Chase Upchurch. They wrote it this summer, 2020, and they will be performing it as well. And last, Uncomfortable Conversations by SRU Music Performance alum Carolyn Lee Golston, written in 2020. It'll be performed by me, senior music therapy major, Matea Sinclair Wise. I would like to thank each of these hardworking students that spent the little free time they did have during a shortened and hectic COVID-19 semester preparing these pieces and helping this project turn from an idea into a reality. I would also like to thank Carolyn Lee Golston for reaching out to me, talking with me, and sharing her experience, and allowing me to perform her beautiful piece. Without any of you, this project will not be what it is today. So, thank you all for tuning in, and I hope you enjoy what we put together this semester.
Hello, my name is Ella Hickey, and today I'll be playing a piece by Samuel Coleridge-Taylor. Samuel Coleridge-Taylor was born in 1875 in England to an English mother and a father originally from Sierra Leone. He studied violin from a young age and went on to hone his skills at the Royal College of Music, making his compositional debut with Ballad in A Minor. As he continued writing, he drew on traditional African music and African-American folk songs. Today, I'll be playing the first of his four African dances. Despite the title African Dances, this piece captures the romantic style violin writing of the day. Throughout his life, Samuel Coleridge-Taylor masterfully blended African and European musical elements. He was one of the first Black composers to be received by the President of the United States, and his trilogy of cantatas, Hiawatha's Wedding Feast, were famous worldwide for several years. Please enjoy the first of his African dances.
Thank you. Since the beginning of time, gender inequality has been prevalent in all cultures in many different ways. Women have always had to accept their fate as less than, and the few that tore away from this mold always had to suffer consequences, a good bit of which resulted in death. Women began finally seeing the light at the end of the tunnel during the decades-long fight that finally ended on August 18, 1920, when women were granted the right to vote. This movement became known as the Women's Suffrage Movement. Though the right to vote did not solve all problems for women, and for many Black women, it did not even apply to them, but it was the first step in beginning to pave a way for women's equality. Composer Ethel Smyth played a big role during this movement. Being the first woman composer to have her work performed at the Metropolitan Opera House in New York City, Smyth would continue to make history, being the first woman to achieve an honorary degree from Oxford University on achievement rather than identity, and the first woman to be made a Dame Commander of the Most Excellent Order of the British Empire. She also made what is now known as the anthem for the women's suffrage movement, called the March of the Women. This song was composed in 1910 with the words of Cicely Hamilton. It is the official anthem of the Women's Social and Political Union. Shout, shout, up with your song. Cry with the wind, for the dawn is breaking. March, march, swing you along. Wide blows our banner, and hope is waking. Song with its story, dreams with their glory. Lo, they call, and glad is their word. Loud and louder it swells, thunder of freedom, the voice of the Lord. Comrades, ye who have dared, first in the battle to strive and sorrow, scorned, spurned, not have ye cared, raising your eyes to a wider morrow. Ways that are weary, days that are dreary, toil and pain by faith ye have borne. Hail, hail, victors ye stand, wearing the wreath that the brave have worn. Long, long, we in the past, cowered in dread from the light of heaven. Strong, strong, stand we at last, fearless in faith and with sight new given. Strength with its beauty, life with its duty. Hear the voice, O hear and obey. These beckon us on. Open your eyes to the blaze of day. Life, strife, those two are one. Naught can ye win but by faith and daring. On, on, that ye have done, but for the work of today preparing. Firm in reliance, laugh a defiance, laugh in hope, for sure is the end. March, march, many as one, shoulder to shoulder and friend to friend.
Schulhoff is an interesting character in the history of 20th century European music. Born to a wealthy Czech family in Prague in 1894, he was primed to be a pioneer to bridge the new and the old styles of music. He showed an early affinity for music and studied extensively in Leipzig, Vienna, and Cologne. During his studies, he drew a lot of influence from the likes of Dvorak and Schoenberg before being enthralled in the new sound of American jazz and the avant-garde. He loved music of all types, composing symphonies, operas, sonatas, jazz, political pieces, and the avant-garde pieces. His music often blurred the lines between the old and the new extremes. His music was considered by the rising Nazi party to be entartete music, or degenerate music. Before he could completely make his mark on the music of his time, his life was cut short in 1942. Urged by his friends, he moved from Prague to the USSR in 1941. Months later, Erwin Schulhoff was arrested by the invading Nazis and he was sent to a concentration camp in Wolfsburg, where he ultimately died. Erwin Schulhoff was Jewish, and for that he was sentenced to death. For the following decades, his music was functionally lost to the world before what was left of his music was rediscovered in the USSR. Schulhoff's story is very similar to many other Jewish musicians in the first half of the 20th century. Who knows how music might have been different had so many musicians and composers not died in the Holocaust. The piece I'm about to play for you was not written in response to the injustices he experienced. He never got the chance to write one for that purpose. I present to you the first movement of Erwin Schulhoff's only piece for solo saxophone, Hot Sonata.
Included the people that did not fit into Adolf Hitler's ideal image. This image was white, straight, blonde, and with blue eyes. This torture and heartless mass murder was near impossible to survive and harder to escape. Out of the estimated 3.5 million people that survived the Holocaust came 3.5 million stories full of heart-wrenching experiences. Two of the people that survived this horribly traumatic event are responsible for one of the biggest songs known to this day, Somewhere Over the Rainbow. The lyrics were written by Yip Harburg. He was the youngest of four children born to Russian Jewish immigrants. The music was written by Harold Arlon, a cantor's son. His real name was Hyman Arluck, and his parents were from Lithuania. These lyrics reflect the experiences the Jewish men and women had to face. Here is Somewhere Over the Rainbow. Someday I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me. Where troubles melt like lemon drops, away above the chimney tops, that's where you'll find me. Somewhere over the rainbow, bluebirds fly, birds fly over the rainbow. Why then, oh, why can't I? Happy little bluebirds fly beyond the rainbow. Why, oh, why can't I?
This is Ain't Gonna Let Nobody Turn Me Round. It's a traditional spiritual that was adapted to become a song of the civil rights movement in the 1960s. It was often sung in a congregational style at mass meetings or rallies by a song leader, and then expanded as the crowd caught on. The Freedom Singers, an outgrowth of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, or SNCC, brought the song new life as part of the Albany movement in Georgia in 1962. The group consisted of Cordell Reagan, Bernice Johnson, Rutha Mae Harris, and Chuck Neblett. The body portion of the lyric tends to change depending on the movement at hand. Bernice Johnson Reagan mentions in a previous 2014 White House performance that in 1962, the group was particularly engaged in a deep struggle, and a federal judge had issued an injunction naming who they thought were the leaders of the movement. Well, Reverend Samuel Wells of Shiloh Baptist Church said in response, "Ain't gonna let no injunction turn me round." And thus, that verse was born. Originally written and performed by Holly Near. The song was written in November of 1978. Holly Near is a prominent folk musician and activist, with her activism beginning in the early 1970s in response to the Vietnam War. She was also considered one of the founders of the women's music movement. The song has a really interesting origin story, as it was written the night Harvey Milk was assassinated. Near was driving down to San Francisco with her friend Tori Osborne, and Tori recalls hearing Holly humming this primal guttural sound. By the time they had gotten to San Francisco, she had written two verses. Holly also mentions that about when the song was written, the verse was originally, the verse that you'll hear is gay and straight together, but originally it was gay and lesbian people. And for many people who sang that song that night, that was the first time they said those words out loud. The song went on to become an anthem of the LGBT movement and later found its way into the Unitarian Universalist hymnal.
Over the past 10 years, we have become heartbreakingly accustomed to the fear that at any moment our lives could be ripped from us by a gunman acting out on pent-up emotions. This disgusting trend has seemingly increased in number every year. In 2019, it is said that there were more mass shootings in America than days in the year,
with the number reaching a record-breaking 417. A mass shooting is defined as any shooting where four or more people are shot, excluding the gunman. Out of these 417 shootings, 31 were mass murders. These shootings include a kosher grocery store in Jersey City, New Jersey, Saugus High School in Santa Clarita, California, one in the historic district of Dayton, Ohio, one in a municipal building in Virginia Beach, Virginia, and the worst one at a Walmart in El Paso, Texas. This resulted in 22 people being killed and 24 being wounded. This, along with the shooting in Dayton in particular, are what inspired singer-songwriter Lana Del Rey to write her song, Looking for America. She posted a preview of the song to her Instagram, with part of the caption saying, "In light of all the mass shootings and the back-to-back shootings in the last couple of days, which really affected me on a cellular level, I just wanted to post this video." Took a trip to San Francisco. All our friends said we would jive. Didn't work, so I left for Fresno. It was quite the scenic drive. Pulled over to watch the children in the park. We used to only worry for them after dark. I'm still looking for my own version of America. One without the gun, where the flag can freely fly. No bombs in the sky.
Hi there, everyone. My name is Hannah Floyd.
And my name is Chase Upchurch.
And we wrote the song together a while back.
Yeah, so the genesis of this song, it came right on the tail end of the murder of George Floyd. And so really with any issue, there's always a balance between listening and speaking. And so we wrote this song because we felt like it was our time to speak. Mm-hmm. We wanted to really try to inspire some perspective and really put our energy out there in a very stately way that says, you know, this is what we believe and this is why we believe it. And there's some really complicated issues out there, and we just really wanted to give some perspective on that.
And so how this song is made up is you're going to hear Chase speak, and this, in a way, is the narrative of an ally, of a Caucasian, white American ally with Black Lives Matter and just in general the fight against racism. And then my verse is the perspective of a Black American in America right now, because it's a hard time, but we hope you enjoy, and we hope that you feel moved by it. That I say might not carry weight, but I can't wait while the black community suffers this cruel fate. They say don't protest that way, it's not about race, as we watch another human being die under the weight of a knee. Kneel, not on our time. Cap, not like that, not on our dime. The black experience, I can't breathe as my lungs fill up. You see, it's not that way for me. I feel safe when I walk, I feel safe when I jog, I feel safe when I get pulled over by the cops. I don't fear for my life, I don't fear for my rights, I don't fear because my pigmentation is white. I have privilege that my black brothers and sisters don't have, a responsibility to speak up on their behalf. I'm gonna use my voice to scream Black Lives Matter and help deconstruct these racist systems, watch them shatter. Generations upon generations of killing, rape, and slavery. The world will never be different unless we start admitting that we have a part in these systems of power, both implicit and explicit. Are we hearing their cries? Do we try? Are we listening? Our silence is deafening. Our silence is threatening. Our privilege is apathy, complicit in catastrophe. An entire culture stolen, the slave state. When we turn a blind eye, we are obliged to the hate. So stand up for black lives, black culture, black voices. I can't breathe, can't be a statement we're okay with. Raise your voices, not when it's convenient for you and me. Raise your voices, black lives matter until they're free. Why we fight is for the right to live another day. We can't wash the pain away, so we will pave the way.
Can you hear them now?
now? Can you hear them 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 now?
Hi everyone, I'm Metea Sinclair Wise, and a few months ago, the idea was given to me to sing this song by Dr. Susan Hadley. She is in charge of the master's program for music therapy here at SRU. She got me in contact with Carolyn to just talk about the song, where it came from, and just our experiences here at SRU. So we reached out, we were in contact, we had a great conversation, and she basically explained to me that this song was birthed out of just everything going on with the racial tensions, the divides in our country, and just her experiences as a Black woman and the treatment she's received over the years. The song really resonates with me. I can completely relate to it, being a Black woman myself and being a Black woman at SRU, a predominantly white institution. And we shared our experiences about how, sadly, not a lot has changed since she's been here versus when I've been here, and just how we've both overcome certain things and how we're working with the challenges that were and are still thrown at us. So thank you for tuning in, and we're ending it with Uncomfortable Conversations by Carolyn Lee Goldston.
Talk without shame, we just want the same opportunity.